This is a Media Lab podcast. Welcome to Putting It Together, the podcast that goes through the entire body of work of Stephen Sondheim, show by show, and song by song. My name is Kyle Marshall, your self-described Sondheim expert. Although this week, we're really not talking about a specific song at all. Simple is usually defined as easy to understand. That's not necessarily how you would describe Sondheim, at least not all the time. And there's this new production of Simply Sondheim playing at the Signature Theater located in Arlington, Virginia. Now, I say playing at the theater, but pretty much everyone can enjoy this. By partnering with the online service Marquee TV, you can watch this production from the safety of your own home, at your computer or smart TV, including your Roku or Apple TV. Because the thing is, this was filmed without an audience, on the stage, with all the performers, socially distanced, but it's still great. I thought this was just this wonderful opportunity to talk with the director of the production, Matthew Gardiner. He also happens to be the artistic director of the theater. So that's what you're going to be hearing in this episode. All the information about the show and how to find it online will be in the show notes. But before we get to my conversation with Matthew, if you'd like to help support this show for absolutely free, you can give a rating and review on whatever app you listen to your podcasts in. That's greatly appreciated. And if you'd like to help monetarily, which will only help to grow and make this show better, you can do so over at our Patreon page. Please do not donate if it impacts you negatively financially. Specifically, I need to give a huge thank you to the God That's Good tier from Patreon, the Triumphant Quartet, Jack, Todd, Barry, and Carrie. Let me go thank some sponsors, and then when we return, it'll be me talking with the Artistic Director of Signature Theater, Matthew Gardiner. Put It Together is a proud member of the Alberta Podcast Network, locally grown, community supported. The Alberta Podcast Network promotes and supports Alberta-made podcasts and connects their audiences with Alberta-based businesses and organizations. This week we're brought to you by ATB, and I want to talk to you about ATB's new podcast, The Future Of. Join Todd Hirsch, ATB's Vice President and Chief Economist, as he connects with special guests who offer unique and useful perspectives about the future. Explore how our economy and communities can not only brace for change, but embrace the opportunity it creates. From the future of women in business to the changing nature of work itself, The Future Of helps us understand what's coming and what we need to do today to get the tomorrow we want. Featuring two episodes each month plus bonus episodes, The Future Of includes interviews with top community and business leaders from Alberta and around the world. Subscribe to The Future Of in the Apple Store, Google Play, Spotify, and everywhere podcasts are found. And connect to ask your questions about the future by emailing thefutureof@atb.com. This week, we're also brought to you by the Alberta Podcast Network. So let's go and listen to one of our other great shows.
Hello and welcome to That's a Thing, a sometimes belated, already outdated guide to your teens, tweens, and everything under 20. I'm Elizabeth.
And I'm Karen. Every month we have a conversation across the generation gap about media, pop culture, society, the internet, that kind of thing.
Karen is my mom, and she's old. I am her daughter, and I am young. Together we are one human being, here to share with you.
Sometimes we bring in another human being who's Elizabeth's brother, John, to do a deep dive into memes and stuff like that.
Hi.
Thank you, John. We were named the Outstanding Kids and Family Series at the 2020 Canadian Podcast Awards, so we have that going for us.
Yes, and we will brag about it until the day the podcast ends, because I am petty.
You can find That's a Thing in the podcatcher of your choice. That is That's a Thing. ! You can also find us at albertapodcastnetwork.com. Is that everything?
I think that's it.
Thanks, sweetheart.
Bye!
Matthew Gardiner, thank you so much for joining me here today.
Of course, thank you for having me.
You know, you have what I consider a pretty interesting job. So maybe you can just jump in right away and let people know what it is that you currently are up to.
Yeah, so I am the Associate Artistic Director at Signature Theater, one of the prime spots for producing Sondheim in the United States of America, which is, you know, we have a long history with producing his work. And in this moment, I have sort of been tasked with creating a entirely digital season as we are in a world where live theater isn't possible. And so it was important to me in that season that we have a little bit of Sondheim to be representative of what Signature has been for the last 30 years and what it hopes to continue to be.
What helped make that decision for you? Like, if you're looking at a digital season, of course, why go with a review of sorts rather than like a full production of a Sondheim show?
It's what Stephen Sondheim would allow us to do. You know,
okay.
But also not just that, you know, it's what was realistic in this moment. I think a fully produced production with huge sets and costume changes and actors interacting in a very close manner was just not going to be possible, especially back in November when we filmed it. So we were looking at what would allow some level of social distancing, which is very interesting. Trying to stage love duets socially distant is an interesting challenge. And I long for the days when actors can stand in like clumps, you know, or as opposed to just straight lines. But we, you know, it was, what can we really achieve? And as we were talking with Mr. Sondheim, it was his idea that we reimagine Simply Sondheim, which was a piece that we created back in 2015 to celebrate Signature's 25th anniversary.
So how did you go about then picking which songs to do? Like you said, it's kind of a reimagining of that original show. So how did you go about being like, yes, these are the songs that are of the moment?
Sure. So the entire show was structured by David Loud and Signature's founder, Eric Schaefer, for that 25th anniversary production. And we were, at the time, it was, you know, how do we fit in all of his shows? How do we surprise audiences so it doesn't feel like the same review that people have seen 1,000 times? So there are some like hidden gems in there. There's Goodbye From Now from Reds, and there's you know, Little White House, Who Could Be Blue, which was cut from Follies and has been heard in Marry Me a Little. But, you know, it was really about sort of balancing classics like Lady Who Lunch with the surprises, and also creating a sort of evening that didn't feel like we're making all of these actors, singers, characters, but also at the same time has these wonderful sort of hills and mountains that sort of are encompassed by Sondheim's themes in his shows. You know, there's a sort of love, a sort of passion medley in Act One, and there's a series of love duets that are both optimistic and very cynical in Act Two. So that's sort of where they started for the 25th anniversary. And then for this, we did some juggling of songs and we added one for a very specific performer.
Well, that's what I was going to bring up here is that even though, yeah, there's like not really a story that's going through this show, what I did think was really cool is the there's some emotional similarities of pairing of songs and stuff together. And there's even performers who, again, not a character, but it's like, oh, okay, so this person from this show is playing this character from this show, and there's actually some interesting overlaps of why you would choose that same performer to be in those two shows. So I thought it actually did feel like there was a little bit of a narrative flow to which songs were picked at which moment type of thing, which was fun to see.
Yeah, I was definitely, you know, definitely the idea was a sort of thematic, abstract idea. You know, I didn't want something that was so narrative driven that it would feel cute, because that just doesn't feel like Sondheim to me. Like if I went, okay, here's the older married lady and here's the young ingenue and their journey needs to reflect this through the entirety of a review.
Sure.
A, we've seen that Sondheim review, and B, I wanted something that was more expressionistic.
I want to talk a little bit more about the show, but I want to also delve into a little bit about Signature Theater itself.
Yeah.
I don't know if you know this or not, but I actually have bought a shirt from Signature Theater online.
Sure. It's a very popular shirt.
I know, yes. Which I should have worn, I realized this morning, but I didn't. So that was a missed opportunity. But tell me a little bit about Signature Theater.
Sure. Signature Theater has been, we're now in our 31st season. It was founded 30 plus years ago in Arlington, Virginia, at a moment when, you know, a lot of professional theaters were popping up when the city only had Arena Stage and the Kennedy Center and the Folger. So it was this moment of regional theaters having a sort of birth in Washington, D.C., and Donna Migliaccio and Eric Schaefer were doing a lot of work in community theater in Arlington, Virginia, and they started to get tired of the productions that they were able to do, and they wanted to do something with a little bit of meat on the bones, and they wanted to do Sondheim. And so they decided, as young, naive individuals, that they were going to start a theater company in Arlington, Virginia. And the first season, they did a bunch of plays. And the second season, they said, you know what, that was a respectable season, but we are going to do what we want to do. And we're going to do Sweeney Todd. And it's either going to make or break the theater. And it made the theater. And every season since, Signature has done a Sondheim musical or a Sondheim adjacent musical. As I like to call them. Signature went from performing in a library to performing in a converted bumper plating garage. And now Signature for the last 15 years, 12 years, somewhere in there, has been in its new home. You can't even call it new anymore, but has been in its home in at 4200 Campbell Avenue in Arlington, Virginia.
Yeah, I mean, I've only been able to see pictures. It looks beautiful. I'd love to come and visit sometime just to take a look at it. Where does your journey start with them? Like, how long have you been with Signature Theater?
Yeah, so I've been with Signature for half of Signature's life in some capacity. You know, I started as an assistant working on projects with Eric Schaefer, with Frank Galati, with John Rando, with Anne Rankin, a lot of amazing people that I got to assist both before I was on full-time staff and then when I was on full-time staff as the resident assistant director. And then from there, my job has changed over the last 15 years, and I'm now the associate artistic director, and I've gotten to direct a lot of amazing projects, from new musicals to new plays to several Sondheim musicals over the years. So Signature has kept my interest.
This is kind of a slightly dumb question, but so when you're approaching like a brand new musical, it hasn't been done before, is that freeing for you in some regards, or is it more daunting because it's like, okay, I have to do like a blank slate?
Absolutely more daunting. I think I always say in the world of theater, there's nothing, I'm not specifically about directing, but there's nothing harder than being in a room working on a new musical. At the same time, there's nothing more exciting. There's nothing more thrilling than seeing that come to fruition. But it's a very, it's challenging, you know, to make sure all the pieces are coming together and that you are sort of guiding that ship down the same path. And in other musicals, you're doing that with the company, with the music director, with the choreographer. But now you are adding another part to the equation and a really important part, and that is the composer and the writers. And it definitely makes the process more unwieldy, more daunting. Like, you're constantly asking yourself, are we heading in the right direction? Are people going to understand this? Is this going to be clear? Does this song fit? You know, musicals in particular are a real collaborative challenge, but extremely exciting.
Well, going back in time a little bit, like, were you a theater kid growing up?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. So I started acting or like doing theater type things when I was around 5. I saw my cousin in a very inappropriate production of The Wiz. You can imagine.
So,
but he was in a production of The Wiz, and my brother and I were obsessed. I have a twin brother, and we would dance around in our basement and sing to the soundtrack of The Wiz. And mm-hmm. and one big defining moment for me was, you know, my family, we went to, they took us to see live theater, but there wasn't a ton of money for that. And there weren't a ton of opportunities. So a lot of my theater education was watching like great performances on PBS. And one of the earliest memories is watching The Woods, the first act, not knowing there was a second act until much later. But, you know, I used to like, you know, be in my basement with like a blanket around my shoulders, pretending I was Bernadette Peters in The Last Midnight. And, yeah, so definitely a theater kid. My brother and I did a bunch of professional shows growing up, both film and theater. And then there was a long period of time where I thought I would be a ballet dancer. I was very focused on that. Went to the Washington School of Ballet, studied with Suzanne Farrell. And that love for dance and at the same time an undying love for theater merged into an interest in choreography, which led to direction. And here we are.
I just want to go on record. I still pretend to be Bernadette Peters sometimes. So
who doesn't?
Yeah, why not?
Your hands around each other, yourself, and shake your head.
That's right. That's right. I this is slightly embarrassing. I don't know if I've actually said this on the podcast before, but this was like, I don't know, 5 years ago. I actually rewatched that version of Into the Woods. I got like the DVD copy that you can still get. And I'm so glad people were not around because I was like ugly crying in the middle of my living room. I was like, what is happening?
Yeah. There is nothing. And I'm not saying people shouldn't do productions of Into the Woods, but there will never be that. You know, you're sort of every time somebody says they're doing a production of Into the Woods with hesitation, I go to see it because no one is Joanne Gleason. No one is Bernadette Peters. No one is Chip. You know, it's such everything about that original production was so perfect.
So how do you approach like direction then? Make sure like your vision is being shown up there on stage.
It's a lot about those earliest meetings, both with the design team and the dramaturg, if you're lucky enough to have one. You know, it's about making sure that before you're talking about what something looks like, you're talking about the themes of the show and the ideas of the show and really having sort of deep dramaturgical conversations about why it's not only why it's important just to tell the story, but what the playwright meant when writing the story or wanted to get across when writing the story. Because if your vision supersedes what the playwright intended, then you should probably be directing another play where you actually appreciate what the playwright wrote. And then, you know, it's about in the rehearsal room, once you've had those conversations with the designers and you've built a sort of world that this can live in, then it's about carrying that into the early days in the rehearsal room. You know, I do something in every one of my rehearsal processes, which is not a new idea. It's something from Anne Bogart and Tina Landau and just called source work. Mm-hmm. or crowdsourced dramaturgy, as some people I work with call it, where we're just sort of, before we're even digging into like the music and the script and the, we're just talking about the ideas of the piece. And those steps seem to sort of lead the ship in the right direction. Like just sort of unifies everyone and makes sure that we're heading down the same path.
You know, Sondheim did this interview years and years ago, and he basically said, like, unless your name is James Lapine, there needs to be different people in all those different roles. Like, you need someone in director, the person who's doing music and lyrics, choreographer, and I'm forgetting someone, director, oh, and book writer, and the book writer, right? There needs to be four different people so that you can have those conversations, debates, and make sure the show is as good as it possibly can be. Do you agree with that at all? Or is that something that you fight against?
No, I do. And I think as I get older, I value it more and more. The number of voices in the room sort of looking over the creative process and collaborating together, like that's what makes musical theater so special as an art form, is it's so many artists coming together to create a world together, to create, to tell a story together. I think probably when I was younger, I thought, well, look at Jerome Robbins, look at Bob Fosse, look at, like, I have to do everything.
Yeah, yeah.
That's what a real, like, leader does. They do everything. And as I have gotten older, I have seen the value in not being that kind of leader, of being a leader that is more about, like, collecting other voices and together sort of shaping a piece. I think that has a lot of value.
Yeah, well, I mean, having gone through so many Sondheim songs now on this show, it is fascinating. Like, some of, like, the things that we consider Sondheim's best work is because of those reasons. It's like Hal Prince, like, we just need a song to close out this act, or we need this thing here,
yeah,
or this song isn't working at all, so just write something new so that we can put it into place. And those all seem to be the ones that people remember the most. So I think there is something to that collaboration idea, that you need those other people in the room to push out great ideas.
Totally.
Talking about Sondheim even more specifically here, was Into the Woods, like, your first Sondheim show that you saw?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And the other thing is, like, I've been saying to people, like, you know, we're in a moment where, what are we doing? Like, what are we creating? We're creating films, we're creating theater, we're creating theater on film. And is there value in that? Is that even theater? And I think about a lot of certainly Into the Woods was, like, a defining moment for me as a young person and as a theater artist. I think almost all Sondheim musicals, the first time I saw them, of the ones that there are, I saw them on film. Like, I saw Sweeney Todd with Angela Lansbury. I saw Sunday in the Park with George with Bernadette and Mandy Patinkin. I saw Passion with Donna Murphy. Like, those, that's how I saw a lot of his work for the first time, was on film, not actually in a theater. So my major memories of seeing his work on stage was the Sondheim celebration at the Kennedy Center. And that was, like, a mind-blowing summer of theater. And that's where I saw a lot of his work for the first time.
Well, yeah. And I think this is why filming certain productions have such value.
Yeah.
And I get the whole, like, economics, like, why we don't want to release those necessarily and encourage people to come and see the show. But as someone who, like, only gets to, like, New York City very rarely, like, those are also my only way to actually see, okay, that's what the set looked like, that's what the performances, that's what kind of the staging looked like. And I think there's value in that as someone who is interested in theater, be like, oh, okay, so I'm kind of getting this the same feeling that I would be in the theater without actually going there. Of course, nothing's going to, I think, overtake actually being in a seat and seeing that performance live.
Right.
But it makes me want to go and see those even more. Is there a favorite Sondheim show that you have?
Sunday in the Park with George.
There's a painting of...
I mean, I'm always like, there's, like, people are like, what are your top 10 musicals? I'm like, everything written by Sondheim and then everything else. Like, it.
Sure, yeah.
I mean, I love all of them. I love the problem, what people consider the problematic ones. I love Merrily We Roll On. I love Passion. I think it's one of the most beautiful, brilliant pieces of writing ever. But if I had to choose the one, it would be Sunday in the Park with George.
You've directed a production of Sunday, correct?
Uh-huh. Yes.
Yeah. Is there one that you have not directed that you're looking forward to?
Merrily We Roll Along.
You want to do Merrily? Yeah.
Very badly. And I think everybody thinks they know how to solve the issues with it. And
sure.
I don't kid myself that I do, but I think it provides so many amazing opportunities for a director. And I just love the piece. I love the music. I love what the story has to say about sort of losing your way and losing sort of the core of where you started.
My thesis that I have been adding to doing this podcast is that there's certain Sondheim shows that really grow on me the older I get, where it's like I appreciate them artistically when I'm younger, but then they really hit me emotionally the older I get. Company is, like, one of the biggest examples, but Follies is starting to become that. It's like, oh boy, like, the older you get, like, okay, I get what is going on in the show.
Follies is another one. However, that's one where I'm like, I need some more life in me to do Follies. Like, right now I'm like, I could do that. But if I'm really being honest with myself, it's that I just need to be older, you know, need to have had more life to really sort of comprehend the ideas in that piece.
I think that's fair. I mean, one thing I was going to call out here, you know, there's an article, I think it's from the Washington Post, that was talking about you. Mm-hmm. And it says, quote, that you're one of those rarefied musical theater beasts. And I want to know what you think that means.
Yeah, I like that quote. I think there are a lot of directors who can do musicals, like, mm-hmm. and I think there are a few that's, it sort of lives in their bones, like it lives in their bodies. I was raised on Judy Garland movies and Gene Kelly and let's put on a show in a barn. And like that is in my, and I was raised on Sondheim, and I was at the musical theater is in my bones. So is particularly as a young director, as much as I tried to push away from, I'm everything. I can do plays. I can do comedies. I can do musicals. Like, and I believe that, but I also know that in my bones is, I'll take it, rarefied musical theater beast, whatever that means. I think he just meant that it's, you come across that kind of director rarely, which I agree with that.
Do you have a sense, and I know this is sometimes hard for like the person to define it themselves, but like, you know, Hal Prince was considered like this cinematic theater director. And like John Doyle has basically made a name for himself for being like the stripped down versions of musicals that he does. Do you have a specific style you think that is being transposed onto the stage?
I'm sure somebody else could point that out. I mean, I think I know what I am most interested in and why I'm so attracted to musicals is I feel like I bring a lot of heart to it. Like I am interested in the heart of the show. I'm interested in, you know, I think that a lot of people talk about Sondheim as this very, not people who actually like Sondheim, but there are people who talk about Sondheim as being cerebral and cold and hard to connect with. And I think the exact opposite. I think he's the most like loving, compassionate, heartfelt writer, one of the most heartfelt writers. So I think that I am attracted to those stories, and I think I pull out a lot of that in the work that I do.
Yeah, I mean, I've heard that criticism before, and I think I don't really understand where that sense comes from, because I agree with you in that he might not do like that traditional like I love you song, but it's deeper than that, and like it can really hit you emotionally when you get invested with those characters and those shows. So
yeah, Not a Day Goes By does a lot more for me than All I Ask of You from Phantom of the Opera. Like, you know what I mean? Like there's honesty in and humanity in the way he writes, and in other, there's value in all musicals, but there is, it just hits on a deeper level with Sondheim.
So let's get into the actual season of Signature here then. Like you said, you've kind of come up with this digital season. What are the shows that are going to be coming out?
Yeah, so it's a 5-show digital season. It begins with Simply Sondheim, which is streaming right now, which is a musical review of his work, including a cast of 12 and a band of 16. And then that's going to be followed by Daniel J. Watts's The Jam, Only Child. Daniel J. Watts was recently nominated for a Tony Award for his performance in Tina, the musical. This is really sort of his personal story about growing up as a latchkey kid and how he became the amazing artist and performer that he is today. It sort of follows that metamorphosis. We're following that up with a musical that recently had an off-Broadway run about 2 years ago called Midnight at the Never Get, which is written by Mark Sonnenblick, which tells the story of a nightclub in Greenwich Village in the an illegal gay nightclub in Greenwich Village in the 1960s. It is a beautiful and heartbreaking love story. We're following that with After Midnight, which was on Broadway. We're doing a much more a pared down version of that, but it's featuring direction and choreography by Jared Grimes, as well as music direction by Mark G. Meadows, who is a fabulous jazz musician here in the Washington, D.C. area, and a plethora of amazing gifted performers here in D.C. And then we're ending the season with Dominique Morisseau's Detroit 67, which tells the story of a group of friends and family during the Detroit riots in 1967. And it just feels incredibly timely for especially in light of the summer that we all just experienced.
Yeah, I'm really excited to check these out. Yeah. I think there's some really great and deep content that's going to be put on the stage and film so that people can do it. Now, if people wanted to, like, how do they view that, get that, subscribe to that?
We have a partnership with Marquee TV, and they are streaming all of our work. Now, we have had some sort of patrons reach out to us and say, oh, I don't own one of these Marquee TVs. And that's not what it is. Right. Marquee TV is basically like Netflix or Hulu or any of these streaming services. And you can have a subscription to Marquee TV, but that is sort of separate of Signature season. And what we would just encourage people to do is go to sigtheater.org and buy either a subscription, which is $200 for the 5-show season, or you can buy individually each show as they are released. And through the website, it is fairly easy. You know, you'll click to purchase, and then it will send you the link to watch it on Marquee TV.
Yeah, and I'll just say, like, I have been able to enjoy Marquee TV. I actually was sent a link so I could actually view Simply Sondheim, so I've actually been able to watch that. And it's a pretty simple process, to be perfectly honest. It's like you said, it's like a Netflix, that sort of type of system. So it's not difficult to kind of, like, navigate and figure out.
And we picked it because, you know, there's an app on your Roku or your Apple TV or really any smart TV. And it just, you know, Marquee TV has the ability to sort of really protect the project. And it's not just sort of a Vimeo link that is sent out that can be copied. We're excited to be featured on their platform.
I want to end off by getting into Simply Sondheim just a little bit more.
Yeah.
There's something you said kind of near the beginning about, like, putting on a Sondheim review and not wanting to be cute about that. I do want to be cute for just a second.
Sure.
You know, it's called Simply Sondheim, but I don't know if Sondheim is necessarily simple himself. So how do you make Sondheim simple?
I think it's about sort of bringing it to its essence, focusing on the lyrics, focusing on the music. There's a lot to this production, and there's a lot in terms of lighting and sound and film and orchestra, but there aren't sets. There isn't anything to sort of distract from his words and his music. And I think that was the intention of Simply Sondheim. And at the same time, I think there was a little bit of a wink in that title. Mm-hmm. Like,
right.
we know people consider Sondheim not simple. You know, it's his music is so complicated. You know, the same thing I was talking about. It's hard to connect to. There are certain people who talk about it in that way. And to sort of bring it down to use the word simple, I think, is a sort of a wink at those people as well.
How did you audition the actors that are a part of this?
So the cast is made up of predominantly DC's brightest stars, you know? So it wasn't really an audition process. It was, who are the artists that have been an important part of Signature over the years, who, you know, are like all of us struggling right now, who have not been able to perform for the last, what are we going on? I mean, it's almost 12 months, 11 months, who haven't been on a stage. And how do we feature them? How do we not only bring into people's home a little bit of that Signature Sondheim magic, but if we're going to do that, how do we feature the people who have starred in so many Sondheim musicals at Signature over the years? So Tracy Lynn Oliveira, who played Sarah Jane Moore in Our Assassins, as well as Mary Flynn in the last production that we did of Merrily We Were Along. Donna Migliaccio, who's played Mrs. Lovett twice at Signature, who's played the nurse in My Sunday in the Park with George. Bobby Smith, who's, you know, it's the list goes on and on. These people have numerous credits in the DC area, numerous credits at Signature, and numerous Sondheim credits. So it just seemed very logical to me. And then it was a question of a couple of people from outside of DC who also have a connection to Signature. Saleha Pfeiffer was the last voice that we heard sing at Signature Theater in the world premiere of Gun and Powder. Emily Skinner has been on our stage several times. Norm Lewis was Sweeney Todd in our second production of Sweeney. So it was a bit of a family affair. And there are some people who can look on that and be like, it's just the same old from Signature. hopefully they don't look at it that way. Hopefully they see it as this incredible family community of artists that Signature has built. And we value those artists a lot.
I honestly was blown away by some of the performances. I, maybe like you, I feel like passion is sometimes like the one that's kind of ignored. I love passion a lot. But whoever the person is that does that performance of Loving You is like knocks it out of the park. I think it's so good.
Yeah.
There's, of course, some songs that you might expect to be here. Like there's a great version of A Weekend in the Country that gets performed. The opening to Merrily is in there, that sort of thing. What were your favorite songs that were included?
I think particularly on film, I really love Now, Later, Soon. Mm. Like I think we were able to... I love that it was included because, you know, it is a very specific story-driven moment in the musical itself. And so to have this 15-minute long sequence in the middle of a review is an interesting choice that David and Eric made. I love it. And I love the way it is expressed on film and the way we were able to sort of highlight this triangle on film. I really love that. I also really love the, as you say, the passion sequence from that actually starts with a song from Saturday Night.
I'm
All For You. And then is followed by Loving You. Is This What You Call Love? And then that ultimate final moment of passion in a really beautiful arrangement by David Loud. I think that's a really, that has a beautiful arc and sort of speaks to these sort of hills that I was talking about earlier of sort of a thematic journey that then culminates and then we move on to the next idea. And I think that sort of encapsulates that idea really beautifully.
One of my life goals is to see a production of Pacific Overtures at some point, because I also really love that show. And it's poems, right? That's the song that is performed, right? Yeah. That I love too. Like, some great performers there. I don't want to like spoil what I think is somewhat of a surprise, but, and I don't know if this was done in like the last version of Simply Sondheim either, but there is kind of like a duet mashup thing that happens in the second act with like a song from Follies and a song from Merrily that I think is such a smart idea. and it still totally works. Like, is that something that the creative team came up with or was that something that had already been done?
It was something, it was David Loud's arrangement. And I don't actually know when David originally arranged it, but it had been a part, it's a part of Sondheim on Sondheim. Barbara Cook and Vanessa Williams sang it. And then David, who arranged both Sondheim on Sondheim and Simply Sondheim, decided to include it in this as well. And I don't know sort of the history of that arrangement. But knowing David, you know, he has a lot of those amazing sort of mashups in his head. David did the arrangement in The World Goes Round of I think it's, now all the songs are going to escape me, but it's three Candor and Ebb songs, maybe This Time, a song from Funny Lady, and another song that all sort of combine in the most beautiful mashup. So he's sort of the king of that, the original king of the mashup.
Looking forward here then for yourself, definitely people should go and check this out. You've filmed that, obviously, so it's ready to go. I think you filmed like your next one in the series and you're about to start your third production. So what is it like?
Our fourth. So we've wrapped up now. We've wrapped up filming for three and we're in rehearsals for the fourth.
So how is it different directing a theater piece for film rather than just directing a theater piece?
You know, everything feels the same to me. Everything feels the same until you get into the process of filming and like lighting the piece for film. And once you start to see things on camera, the conversations with the actors change slightly about making choices that might be a little more internal than sort of projected out. Like there's a, if it feels too forceful, if it feels too performative, if it feels like I am pushing my performance out to an audience, which is important in the world of theater. And I don't mean that in a way that feels like it's unnatural, but like in the world of theater, our choices have to get across to the back of the audience. And on film, we always hear about like the choices are smaller and that's not really what it is. It's just about, you don't have to project your choices in the same way. So that's a lot of what the conversations are. Also, I will say that, like, there was with Simply Sondheim, you'll notice, and maybe people will watch it and be like, yes, I noticed this and it was extremely boring, but there are a lot of lines. Like, there are a lot of moments where it is just actors standing in a line downstage. And that was out of safety concerns. It was, if I'm going to have this many people on stage, we just need to get them downstage singing out so they're not all singing in each other's faces. And and that's not because we actually, there was tons of testing that was happening. And like, we felt like we were very safe in that room, but we felt like if we were going to put this on film, we didn't want anybody watching it to be concerned about somebody being too close to somebody else singing. Yeah. So what was interesting in filming it or in staging it, I was like, this is so boring. People are going to be so bored. And it took Justin Chiat, and I don't think I said this, but James Gardiner, who's my twin brother, is the editor of it and has done, they've done a lot of film work together. So having them working on this project with me was hugely educational and beneficial, because they would say, Matthew, it may look boring on stage, like them just standing in a line, but you have to remember on film, we can zoom across the line. We can cut to different people in the line. Like, what may feel very stagnant on stage will not feel stagnant on film.
Yeah, I would agree with that too. Like, there are some great dramatic zooms that kind of come up in and show off what's going on. So I think that there's enough of that to keep people's interest.
Totally.
Do you storyboard this at all? Or are you kind of just leaving that up to the production crew to figure out how to actually capture it?
There is a lot of conversation about sort of what we imagine, like in this moment, I want the cameras to be more still. I don't want a ton of movement from the cameras. In this moment, it's sweeping and it can have that sort of movement, but I'm relying on the much more talented film minds that are surrounding me in this moment to help me understand what is possible. You know, I had before this, I had never heard of, you know, a Ronin or a Steadicam or like color correction or stabilization. Like, there are so many things that I've learned in the last 8 months about film. And that's, you know, I think that is a lot of directors who are jumping into film work for the first time rely heavily on their director of photography to help them sort of understand what the possibilities are. So I got very lucky in having Justin Chiat and James Gardiner sort of guide me into this world.
Well, Matthew, thank you so much for joining me here today. I'm excited to check out, honestly, the rest of Signature's season. I think there's some really strong work that's going on here. And I really love the fact that there is a theater that is like, we are making it a mission to not just have like Sondheim's work put on display, but also like new voices and that sort of thing, and championing those as well. If people wanted to stay in contact with either you or Signature Theater, what is like the best way to do that online?
Our website, you know, go to sigtheater.org, and you know, you can find lots of different ways to be in touch with us. To, you know, go to our social media pages, both mine as well as Signature's, to sort of follow what is happening.
Great. Thank you, Matthew.
Totally. Thank you.
Thank you so much for listening. You can send emails to puttingittogetherpodcast@gmail.com. Also, you can follow Sondheim Podcast on Twitter and Instagram. And you can support the show on Patreon by going to patreon.com/puttingittogetherpodcast. Thank you to the Alberta Podcast Network and to ATB this week. Putting It Together is available on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Spotify, and pretty much anywhere you can get podcasts from. Consider subscribing so that you never miss an episode. Next week, we'll be back to talking about A Little Night Music, specifically the two night waltzes from Act 2. Don't sing a nocturne just yet. As always, a big thanks to the great Chris Taniguchi, who designed the podcast artwork, and to Nick Driscoll for composing our theme music. Well, we've reached the end of our episode. Yes, I know. Goodbye for now.